kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church.
To our service today. We're glad that you've chosen to worship with us at Newgate Baptist Church in Calgary, Alberta. And we just hope that you will, you know, punch in your name, let us know that you're here, like the service today, or, you know, subscribe to it on YouTube or whatever, so that we can know that you were part of our service today. Matthew's going to read from Psalm 61 as we begin our worship today.
Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been my refuge a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you, God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Increase the days of the king's life, his years for many generations. May he be enthroned in God's presence forever. Appoint your love and faithfulness to protect him. Then I will ever sing in praise of your name and fulfill my vows day after day.
Lord, we come to you today and we want to just praise your name. We want to lift your name high for all that you have done for us. And Lord, we thank you that your presence is with us, and we want to glorify you for all that you are today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Join us as we sing today. We're starting with "This Is Amazing Grace," because that's what we want to just declare, God's amazing grace today.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty
and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless with awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings the chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
King of my heart.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. And you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are
never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh.
Hi, everyone. It's good to be able to communicate a little, even though we can't get together and see each other. And Julie asked me just to share a little bit, and I had a hard time thinking of what that should be. And then I kept thinking of a couple books I've read lately, and just things in them that have really spoken to me. And one of them is called 1 Minute After You Die. And in there, it just made me realize how important it is for each of us to make sure that we're right with Jesus and to share with others. Because in here it says that 1 minute after you die, you will either be enjoying a personal welcome from Christ or catching your first glimpse of gloom as you have never known it. Either way, your future will be irrevocably fixed and eternally unchangeable. So it just really shows us how important it is to make sure that we're right with God. And one other book I've been reading is called Found Faithful. And it's a book about some of the real committed Christians over the years, like Charles Spurgeon and Amy Carmichael, C.S. Lewis, Ruth Graham. And something that was a real encouragement to me is actually a quote that someone had given from Oswald Chambers. And he said, The things that make God dear to us are not as much his great big blessings as the tiny things, because they show his amazing intimacy with us. He knows every detail of our individual lives. And I think at a time like this, when there's so much going on that isn't good, and just to focus on the little things, because God is there and he cares about every little detail. And so anyway, I hope you're all doing well, and I look forward to seeing you. Thank you.
Thanks for your testimony, Joan. It was great to see you and to hear your voice. We're just so happy to be able to stay connected with people like that. So please, if you would like to send a greeting, make sure that you do that. You can just video your family or you as an individual. Even if you're not from our church regularly, but you've been connecting from somewhere else, you know, feel free to send that to us too. We would love to hear your voice. I just want to make reference to a few of the announcements. Make sure that you watch them again at the end of the service so that you know what's going on this week. But we really want to invite you to our Bible study on Monday night at 7:30. It's just been a really great time of discussing how we can meet the needs of younger generations as a church in general, and as the Christian church worldwide, what we can do differently, how we can really instill a strong sense of faith in Jesus Christ in generations that are coming up. So we hope that you are a part of that. We're going to continue to worship God together.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing of his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is of light and canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. And you alone are the matchless King. You alone be all majesty. No glories and wonders no tongue can recite. You breathe in the air, and you shine light. Oh, measureless might, ineffable love, while angels delight to worship above. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our maker, defender, redeemer, and friend. And you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. The glories and wonders what tongue can recite. You breathe in the air, and you shine light. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. Oh, gratefully sing of his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise.
We're going to sing He Knows My Name.
I have a maker. He formed my heart before even time began. My life was in his hands.
Let's sing that again.
I have a maker. He formed my heart before even time began. My life was in his hands. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. I have a Father. He calls me his own. He'll never leave me, no matter where I go. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. And he knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call.
Sing that one more time with us.
And he knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. He hears me when I call.
God, we just thank you so much that that is the truth, that you hear us, that we can cry out to you and you hear our voices, that you love us enough to take concern with all of the things that goes on, that go on in our lives. Lord, we thank you for that. And today, wherever we are at, whatever our lives are at right now, if we are in time of rejoicing or time of sorrow, Lord, we pray that we will know that you are with us, that you are beside us, that you are our encourager, you are our strength. Lord, we thank you that you are our loving Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jeff's going to continue to teach us from the Word of God today.
All right, well, this morning we're going to continue our series of looking at faith on the margins, from the margins to the margins. And I've kind of tongue-in-cheek referred to it as a series on marginal faith. And I think that's a great title for it, but I also think it gives us a little bit of a wrong idea, because oftentimes when we talk about something being marginal, you know, like we talked about last week, we can get this idea that it's weaker than or not as strong as. And certainly I think that marginal faith, or faith from the margin to the margins, faith of the margins, is actually a very strong faith. You see, because that's where we see Jesus operating so often. And as we want to pursue our lives, you know, modeling our lives after what Jesus did, I think that it calls us to the margins. And so as we look at this passage that we're going to look at today, I want us to keep that in mind, that this is, yes, faith about life in the margins, and yet it's also about the way that, God works in that space and actually where we're able to grow in that space. And so last week, we discussed that Jesus came from the margins. We looked at his family history. We looked at his birth story. And we talked about the fact that, Jesus doesn't just meet us in the margins. He was always there. And so for some of us, as we struggle with who we are and how we can be used by God because of marginality that's been placed on us by others and often by ourselves, we're reminded that, Jesus is right there with us. And he's going to use us. And so this morning, we're going to look at a story of Jesus and an unnamed woman whose daughter is demon-possessed. And it is a story that appears in both the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to look at the account from the Gospel of Matthew. So I'm going to read Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 to 28. And I encourage you to pull out your Bible and read along. It might not be the same version. It might not even be in English, but I encourage you, because I think that there's something important about reading these stories in their context, right? And to recognize that we're not just pulling bits and pieces out, but it's part of a fuller story. And so I encourage you to, like I said, to read it from your Bibles. But I'm gonna read it. You can follow along. It also will be appearing on the screen. And so it says this: "Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, 'Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly.' And Jesus did not answer a word. And so his disciples came to him and urged him, 'Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us.' And he answered, 'I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel.' And the woman came and knelt before him. 'Lord, help me,' she said. He replied, 'It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs.' 'Yes, it is, Lord,' she said. 'Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table.' And then Jesus said to her, 'Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted.' And her daughter was healed at that moment." Let's just pray and then let's dig into this passage. Lord God, we just thank you for this account of this woman and her tremendous faith and her tremendous need, and that she was able to bring it to Jesus. And that because of that, right, because of her faith and because of God's grace, because of Jesus' healing power, she was able to get the result that she was seeking. And God, we just want to learn from this story. We want to learn from this woman who has no name, and yet her story has been told for thousands of years. And so, God, let us learn from it fresh this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, well, as we look at this account, we're going to be breaking it down into four sort of different sections. The first thing is we're going to talk about the setting and the context, because I think for us to understand this story fully, we have to understand where it was taking place. And so the first thing is the setting and the context. The second thing is we want to actually look at the interchange between Jesus and this woman. We want to look at the conversation, what was there, what wasn't there. And then we want to look at what was the result, right? What happened because of this engagement? What happened because of this interaction? And then the fourth thing we want to do is we want to apply it to our own lives and say, what is it that we're to learn from this? How are we to respond, right? How are we to respond? So the first thing we want to do is look at the context. So again, like I said, this passage isn't just sort of on its own floating out there. It's attached to a number of other stories. And if we look at what's been happening in the life and ministry of Jesus leading up to this point, it's been a very fruitful time of ministry, but it's also been a very difficult time, right? We've seen the feeding of the 5,000. We've also seen the death of John the Baptist, right? We've seen that Jesus is starting to gain some momentum in terms of his public ministry. He's gone from just small gatherings to thousands and thousands of people coming to hear him teach, to be healed by him. And so he's starting to come under the scrutiny of the religious leaders and also other people that are sensing that there's a power shift that's coming, right? That there's something about this itinerant preacher that's been walking the countryside. All of a sudden, there's something that's growing and it's different. And it's at this point that Jesus actually decides, this is not the time, this is not the place for him to move that forward, that you know, he's waiting for when it's just right. And we know that, right? We talked about that. In the fullness of time is a phrase that gets used in the Bible a lot when it talks about how God's timing, right? And God's timing. So Jesus says, this isn't the time and the place, and so he retreats. He goes north. In fact, he keeps going north. He leaves Galilee, in fact, and he winds up outside of Galilee in a Gentile region. We read that it is Tyre and Sidon. And so that's north of Mount Carmel, right? And it is definitely outside of, you know, what people would assume would be sort of the place that good Jewish people would be, because it's a land of pagans, it's a land of Gentiles, it's the land of the Canaanites. Right? See, Tyre and Sidon, they don't get very good Yelp reviews. You know, they throughout the Old Testament, they were seen as being the enemy. They were these strong cities that needed to come down. And so there's lots of passages in the Old Testament that you can look up and you can see that they were not seen as being a friendly place for followers of God to be. And even in the New Testament, I mean, we're reading out of Matthew 15, just a few chapters earlier, is where we read those words of Jesus where he says, "Woe to you," right? And he gets after, you know, Bethsaida and Chorazin and, you know, some of the other, you know, other places, saying that if you had even the faith, right, to see the miracles that are being done, right? Even if Tyre and Sidon saw them, they would come under under my blessing, but you don't. So again, the idea is Jesus is going to a place that you shouldn't go, right? You shouldn't go. Woe to you, right? Is sort of the you know, the city slogan for Tyre and Sidon. This wasn't a place to be if you were a pious follower of God, right? The people that were coming down on Jesus, the people that were trying to scrutinize and find fault in him, right? The Pharisees, one of the groups there, they basically had two major measurements on piety. And we could, one of the commentaries I was reading said that it boiled down to bank book and yardstick, right? That those were the two metrics. That if you are a really pious person, you would be incredibly wealthy. God would bless you in a material way. And the other way you could tell if someone was pious or not is how far away they kept from the sick, the unclean, the poor, right? And so we see that you either had lots of wealth or you kept sick people away. And Jesus, again, Jesus comes and he tips those metrics upside down, and it must have just really confused the leaders of the day when they saw him spending so much of his time with the poor and the sick. Not very pious. But this was a move that was incredibly unpious, going north into the land of the Gentiles, into the land of the Canaanites. And in the Gospel of Mark, it says that he actually goes into a house. And it actually gives us the idea that he was just trying to get away, and he actually didn't make his presence known, and so he goes in. But see, he was famous already. People from the Canaanite region had heard of what he was doing. In fact, some of them, we read in some of the other stories of his ministry, they had come and they had heard and they had seen the healing that he did. And so when he comes into the region, this woman finds out about it and she comes to him. Now, I have to admit that this is a strange, even a troubling passage to read, right? As we read it, right, there's some stuff in there that jumps out at you that you say, wait a second, is this really, you know, what Jesus wants us to act like? You know, his response to her is not very WWJD bracelet wearing kind of responses, right? And we're going to dig into that, but I think that it's something that as we read it, you know, it can challenge us. And so often that's the way that Jesus helps us to grow is through challenging us. And so let's look at this passage and the conversation that he has, right? She comes in verse 22. It says that a Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Right? His first response to her is to not say a word. He just ignores her. And she keeps pleading. She keeps going. She just doesn't stop, right? And even the words that she uses, "Lord, Son of David," Right? Those are powerful words to come off the lips of a Canaanite woman because she is saying there, she is acknowledging that the ancestors of Jesus ended the empire of her ancestors. Right? That we look at the Old Testament account and we see that it was David and the ancestors of David that led to the demise of the Canaanites. Right? And it wouldn't have been easy to do. Right? It wouldn't have been easy to admit that, to voice that. But she is insistent and she is persistent and she just keeps pleading and prompting. Right? So do this. This is what I want from you. This is all I'm asking from you. I know you can do it. You have the authority. You have the ability. Right? She knows who Jesus is more than the people that were chasing after Jesus and chasing Jesus out of the places he just was. Right? She knows who he is at a heart level, and she just keeps going. In fact, we get this sense that she was so persistent, right? She was so persistent that the disciples just say, just send her away, right? Get rid of her. Enough already, right? In verse 23, the disciples came to him and urged him, send her away. She keeps crying out after us, right? The way we can interpret this is sort of one of two ways. We can either see it as them saying, come on, Jesus, just send her packing. Tell her to leave. Tell her to go away. But we might also understand it as this, and that is that they have seen this kind of persistence before. That when people have come wanting to get that healing from Jesus, nothing will stop them. They will go through anything. They will literally pull roofs apart to be able to bring their cause before Christ. And so they see in her something about the way that she's pleading, something in her eyes or in her voice that they know she's not going to leave until she gets what she's come for. And that they might be just saying, you know, do what she wants so we can get on with our day. I don't know if you've ever been a parent or looked after a young child that, you know, they're just persistent. They just keep going. And then eventually you just say, fine, have it your way, right? It's easier. I don't know. We don't get a real sense, and there's nothing in the grammar that tells us one versus the other, but it just seems to be the way it is, right? We've seen that with those disciples before, right? They're very quick to say, send her away, right? They did that if we look in different passages, right? If we look at the feeding of the 5,000, they said there's not enough food. Tell them to go back home. We see that with the children that are being brought for the blessing, and they say, come on, Jesus, just tell them to go away. We see that with the Samaritan village where they say, hey, come on, Jesus, let's just call down, you know, lightning and fire and get rid of them. Like, they were quick to say, let's just move on. And in each of those cases, we see that Jesus has a different response. And Jesus shows them something in his response. And so Jesus at first ignores. But then finally he does engage. And we see that, right? That Jesus' first verbal response is to make his mission known, right? He wants everybody in that space to know, I was sent for the lost sheep of Israel. Right? He has a focus, right? He's here for a reason. That idea of being a lost sheep of Israel, nothing could be farther from being part of Israel than being a Canaanite, right? That long history of the two parties battling all through the Old Testament and the Inner Testament, right? Like, there's been such a long history of fighting between them that to be a Canaanite is to be as far from being an Israelite as you can possibly be. And Jesus says, I'm here for the Israelites. I'm here, right? I read that and I couldn't help but be reminded of another interaction that Jesus had with an unnamed woman. And maybe we'll take a look at that another time, but with the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, right? Jesus made sure that she understood what his mission was, and he told her point blank, salvation comes from the Jews, right? He wanted her to know that. And I think that's important for us to understand as well, that Jesus had a mission. It was clear, it was stated. Right, he was focused on it, but she keeps pleading. She keeps pleading. Please, Lord, right? Please, Lord, right? Help me, Lord. Right? It just keeps going, and so Jesus responds to her directly, and his response is the one that kind of catches you off guard. He says to her, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Read that again, right? Jesus says, you're a dog, right? Can you imagine if that was the case today, right? Twitter would blow up. News services would lose their minds, right? Jewish leader calls marginalized woman, you know, a dog, right? Sponsorship would be canceled, right? Speaking engagements would be taken off the table, all of those things. But when we read that, we have to understand that Jesus is not a racist. Jesus is not a misogynist. So what did he mean? And I think that's one of the things we have to do when we encounter passages that kind of stir us and rattle us, right? We're not always going to understand everything in the Bible. So we got to dig into it and we got to figure it out. And when we realize that that's not who Jesus is, so what did he mean by that, right? Well, I think one of the things that we understand is first and foremost is Jesus identifies with this woman. Jesus identifies with her marginalization. Why do I say that? Because this woman is a Canaanite. And in the genealogy of Jesus, we see that not once but twice we see that Jesus has Canaanite women listed in his genealogy. They're not tucked away. They're not hidden. He's very open, right? It's very open that this is who he is. Tamar and Rahab were both Canaanite women, and they're both part of his line, right, in his birth story. So he identifies with these women, and that's the first part. The second thing that makes me say, well, I can't read this as a racist or a misogynistic statement, is that the woman doesn't react in offense, right? So her reaction isn't one. And I've read a lot of different commentaries, and not everybody agrees with that statement, but I do think that as we look at what the woman has to say, right, she doesn't react out of offense. So that must mean she has a different received meaning than we do. Right? Now, I want to make sure I also warn people, don't call people dogs, right, and say, don't be offended. I'm just using the term dog in a biblical way, right? That's not what I'm saying, but I am saying that when we see this and when we read it, we have to dig a little deeper than just our first response. And I think that's, for us as a community, as a congregation, that makes sense. Many of us at Newgate have had to learn a new language for work or because we've moved to a new country, right? And we know that words don't always translate clearly or exactly. And I think part of that is what we're seeing in this passage. You see, because there's different words for dog that could have been used, right? There are words that talk about being a street dog or a mutt or that are just out and out designed to be insulting. But the word that Jesus uses is a different word for dog, and it means maybe more along the lines of like a pet or a lap dog, right? And so Jesus uses this, and he's speaking more about hierarchy than he is about insult. And so that might take some of the sting out of him calling this woman a dog, but it still leaves the question of, well, but why? Why would he call her a pet? Why would he diminish her like this, right? I mean, she's already obviously distressed. She's already obviously in a place where, you know, where she is powerless and she's asking for favor of Jesus. Why would he do that? So many commentaries, so many explanations, right? And I'm not going to go through all of them, you know, this morning, but there are lots of different ideas out there. But I'll say the one that resonated with me was the idea that Jesus was doing the same thing that he did with his disciples and that he did with lots of other people. And that is, he is pushing them. And so by calling her this name, by referring to her in this way, he's pushing at her, right? Pushing at her to see her level of resolve and how much faith she had, right? Did the woman really want this thing that she was asking for? How badly did she want her daughter's healing? How desperate was she for that demon to be removed? Right? And so if you've ever, you know, been a coach, a parent, whatever, you've probably done something similar where you call someone out and you want to see if they're going to respond. I remember playing sports, and you know, lots of times the people would question your heart by calling you names, right? So, do you really want this? Are you really going to dig deep on this? Or are you just going to pack up your stuff and go? And I'll admit that my dad was my coach through a lot of my hockey career, and he used it as a coach, not so much as a parent, but he would call me out, right? He would call me out. How much heart do you really have? Do you really want this? And so I think that that's some of what Jesus is doing. And she responds with a sense of continued faith, right? She just very quickly responds that even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. She's saying, I understand where I sit. I understand who I am before you. I still want what you have. And even if it's just a crumb from you, that's all that my daughter needs, and she'll be saved. She'll be healed. And Jesus is pleased. Jesus is pleased by that response. And so that takes us to the next part, and that is the result. So we talked about the context, and we talked about the conversation. Now as we look at the result, it's almost anticlimactic, isn't it? And it's almost anticlimactic. Jesus just looks up and says, woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. Stamp, right? And we read that right then her daughter is healed, right? It was a good answer. It was a good answer. And so your daughter is healed. It was in an instant, and it was from a distance. The daughter is healed. See, I believe, right? I believe that this is what Jesus was going to do anyways. I believe that's why he was there. Right? I think he knew he was going to heal this daughter. I think he knew that he was going to grant this woman's request long before she ever voiced it, right? Because Jesus didn't travel all the way to that region of Tyre and Sidon to have this interaction with this woman and then turn her down. I truly believe he knew all along that he was going to perform the miracle, but he wanted the woman to be part of that. And he also wanted the disciples to learn from that, right? And I think that transfers to us. And I think that talks a little bit about what are we to learn from this? How are we to respond to this, right? So that brings us to us. So how do we respond? What are we to learn from this account? Why has it been told and retold for millennia, right? I think that there's a few things that we need to pull out of this. One is that God is at work where we don't expect it. In fact, he's at work in places where we don't even want him to be working in, right? If we look at that, we see that Jesus went to this place that he actually warned his followers not to go to at different times, right? But he goes there. He's at work there. And I think for us today, we have to understand that there are Canaanite sections of our society. There are places where God is working that we might be scared to enter into. We might even be mad that God is working in that area. We want those people to suffer the full weight of what they do and what they've done. And it's where Jesus is working. It's where Jesus is active. I think that there's also Canaanite sections in our own lives. There are parts of our heart, parts of our mind that we don't want Jesus to come to. We wish he would stay clear of there because we know that it's no good. It's like Tyre and Sidon. And yet that's where Jesus goes. So first thing we need to learn from this is that God is at work in those places that we don't expect it, and maybe we even don't want him to be there. That we're in right now, I don't know about you, but in this season of introspection. And a lot of us have time to think about things that maybe we haven't thought about. We're stuck listening to our own thoughts more than we're used to. And so there's that Tyre and Sidon of my own mind. We can't be too quick to get Jesus to move out of that space. Don't tell Jesus, let's go, let's go, let's go, right? He's brought us here for a reason, right? He's brought us here for a reason. So we need to sort of dig in and figure out what is it that God wants us to do in this place, right? The second thing that I think we learn from this passage is that it might not always be comfortable as Jesus tests our resolve for healing. We pray for a lot of stuff, and it's great, and it's a wonderful privilege that we're able to come before God in prayer. But it's not always comfortable to be in that place of prayer. It's not always comfortable to be in that place of requesting healing and waiting on God's healing. You know what? Sometimes we hear things that we don't want to hear. We might not be called a dog, but maybe we get called racist or bigoted or closed-minded, right? Maybe we have other things that get thrown at us. And we've got to sit in that place and we've got to work through it. Just like that Canaanite woman, we've got to respond in a way where we say, what is it that's part of that name? What is it that's part of that thing? And what do I learn from it? Not just react, but actually learn. And the last thing that we have to do is we have to trust that the struggle is worth the healing, right? Or that the healing is worth the struggle, right? That there was nothing easy or comfortable about what that woman had to go through. But she believed that Jesus could, and she believed that Jesus would provide that healing for her daughter. And that's what allowed her to stay strong and to stay focused and to stay faithful. And for us, it's the same thing. As we struggle through things, we have to make sure that we stay focused on the goodness of God, the sovereignty of God, the fact that Jesus could and Jesus would, that Jesus will, you know, do the thing that we request, right? That healing will come, that restoration will come, that reconciliation will take place, that the way things are now aren't the way they have to always be, that we will come to a time and a place of shalom, right? That peace of everything fitting together the way that God has intended it to. But until we get there, it's going to be difficult and it's going to be challenging. And it just reminds us that this marginal faith isn't easy. But this is where we grow the most, right? Easy believism never built strong faith. But faith from the margin, faith to the margins, faith of the margins, that's where we grow, right? That's where we grow. And so let's pray and let's commit ourselves this week to really looking at what it is that God's calling us into some of the messy stuff, into some of the marginal stuff. And he's going to work through that. And it's not going to be comfortable, but he's going to help us come out the other side with that healing. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this passage, for this example that we get from this Canaanite woman that comes to Jesus. And there's so many reasons why she should have just walked out or just walked by even. And yet she knows that Jesus can and will heal her daughter. That the grace and the love and the hope of Jesus is so powerful that it'll transcend any barriers, political or racial or ethnic or, you know, tradition, all of those things, that Jesus can transcend that, and he does. And so, God, we thank you. We thank you that Jesus has a clear and focused mission, and yet that includes all of us, right? That God is at work in the margins, and that he calls us to be part of that work. So God, I pray that this week as we go out, we will go out, you know, looking for opportunities to serve you and to grow. And so we pray all of these things, Lord, in your precious name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Will you join with us for our last song, Cornerstone? We want to make this our prayer as we go out that, you know, that God is the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone that we want to build our lives on this week.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that first verse again.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I'll rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. He shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone. For blessed to stand before the throne, Christ alone,
we just come before You today, and we ask that You will be that cornerstone for us. We declare that we want to build our lives on Jesus Christ today and every day. So as we live our lives this week, Lord, we pray that You will help us to look to You in every situation, whether we are in a struggle or in a triumph or just in ordinary everyday life. Lord, we pray that You will turn our eyes to Jesus, so that we can live our lives based on the foundation that You give us. Lord, we want to be Your people in the truest sense of that word, where we are following after You, where we are seeking to be like our Heavenly Father, where we want to be Your children every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise, my song will rise to You. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise, my song will rise to You. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise You, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to You. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to You. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise You, Lord. Presence now, I come alive, I am alive with You. There is strength.
darkness I